All right, guys, settle down. Settle down. Take some food and put it in your mouth. And our first speaker really doesn't need any introduction. Every Chinese researcher in the room probably has participated in one of the programs or competitions named after him. For his contribution to mathematics and outreach in China, he's often called the Emperor of Chinese Mathematics. Please join me in welcoming Fields Medalist Professor S.T. Yao.
Okay, thank you, Greg. I'm not expert in this field, but I'd like to talk about it. So this works by team of David Gu and many other people relate to mathematics and computer science. So it largely relate to nonlinear theory with optimal transportation and all that. So yes, geometry, which I have been working for a long time. I'm not sure about deep learning because I don't know much about learning and neither is deep or maybe superficial, but anyway. So here is the outline of the talk, manifold distribution hypothesis, manifold learning, optimal transportation, and several other things related to this. So attempt to make some explanation of Mach collapse and all that. So let's start with manifold distribution hypothesis. So this is the deep learning conference. This is related to many machine learning tasks, including image recognition, machine translation, speech recognition, and so on. The theory needs to understand much better, and we are trying to make some attempt to understand some of this. We are interested in this well-accepted manifold distribution and the clustering distribution hypothesis. So the work that we are talking will be based on this hypothesis. So manifold distribution would be assuming natural high-dimensional data concentrate close to a nonlinear low-dimensional manifold. When the dimension is very large, the manifold could still be quite large dimension. And practically any interesting manifold are sitting in big Euclidean space. That's a well-known statement. So many data should be possible to be reflected by the low-dimensional manifold. Except, of course, the manifold usually has some singularity. Clustering distribution. So the distance among the probability distributions of subclasses on the manifold are far enough to discriminate them. Okay. So the probability distribution on the, of subclasses on the manifold, we measure the distance and try to discriminate them. So deep learning method can learn and represent the manifold structure and transform the probability distributions. So there are two types of embeddings. So here we have a 28 by 28 pixels. It's treated as a point in the image space. So all the figures is embedded into a huge Euclidean space out to the power 28 by 28. And of course, that's a huge dimension Euclidean space where most of them are redundant. And so you're supposed to sit in a much lower dimensional curved submanifold. The Hamilton digits image manifold is only two dimensional. Each digit corresponding to a distribution on the manifold. So there are two, on the left there's a manifold and then there's a embedding on a latent space in this picture. And this is a different embedding result with inferior quality. And there, because there are some redundancy and some superimposed image. And a general model is ambient space is a big Euclidean space. And manifold is support of a distribution mu. So the distribution is support in a sigma submanifold. The parameter space, parameter domain is another latent space, Rm. And on the manifold, we map the coordinate, phi I, into the latent space, Rm. So this is like a chart for the manifold. And phi ij compare different probability measures. So different charts and trying to understand what's going on the manifold. That's what we have been doing in geometry for the last 100 years. And we are looking at it in terms of probability, density, and all that. So what's a manifold that we see as a geometer? It's a topological space covered by a set of open sets. So U alpha are coordinate charts, which measures what's going on in that spot. And there's a homomorphism which mapping U alpha to Rn to the latent space, and this form a chart. The union of such charts form an atlas, and their transition function measuring one side to another side. The reason we need that is because the manifold need not be one piece, like simply connected Euclidean space. You may have topology, and you are forced to use different charts to cover the manifold. Just like sphere, you need at least two coordinate charts to glue them together. So this is a concept come up by Hermann Weyl, actually, about 100 years ago. So let's take an example. So we have a Buddha sitting in free space, Euclidean free space. The data manifold is the Buddha. Sigma, we call it. The image space is R3, Euclidean free space. And the encoded map is what we discussed earlier, the coordinate map. It's a map from sigma into the latent space. Decoding map is an inverse image of that. So the right-hand side is a coordinate chart of this Buddha. So it's spread out, so it's somewhat different from the actual Buddha, but it's a chart, you can see. So you map the right-hand side, you map the left-hand side to the right-hand side, okay? And also, you can map in different way. Then you glue them together. So there's a chart transition between two different coordinates, and you glue them together to understand what's going on. And naturally, some of them is smaller here and bigger here, and the chart tells you how to move one to another one. And there's uniform distribution on the latent space, so there's more uniform distribution because we know the sphere or the disk much better, and we put points on there, uniform distribute. And then under the chart, we put it back on here, produced by decoding map. Okay, so at one point it's uniform, and when you come back, it's no more that uniform. So there's a different chart, and there's uniform distribution mapping into there in a different manner. So different. So here there are less points, and because I use different chart, and here there are more points here, so you get more distribution on the head. So this because of different chart, and although the distribution is the same here, but because we use different chart, you get different distributions. So well, look at all this. A facial image is determined by finite number of genes, DNA and all that, lighting conditions, camera parameters, and large amount of different parameters. All of them together form a manifold, so space of all facial image. And given a parametric representation, randomly generate a parameter in here, so randomly chosen according to white noise, normal distribution. The image is a human facial image. The point here corresponds to a point on the right hand side. It's a human facial image. And this, the noise is a point. We can denoise it by choosing the closest point on the manifold that we want as a shortest distance to that point. Okay? So that's what we look at as a denoising procedure. This is a point with noise, and the image is the space of the manifold of space that we learned, I mean we get. And so P would be the denoised image. So this so sigma is a clean facial image manifold, so we collect all those phase, and the noise image is a point closest to sigma. And the closest point is the resulting denoised image. So that's how we call manifold denoising. Okay, the traditional method, one traditional method at least, is use Fourier transform the noisy image, filter out the high frequency component, and use the inverse Fourier transform back to the denoised image. So cut off the high frequency part. So that's pretty good for many things. But this is a rather universal way of doing things. So it is not quite adept to the things that you have. For example, in here, we know we are looking at human faces. So this type of things do not give you any information you are dealing with human faces. So this manifold learning method, we call it, you use a clean facial image to train the neural network, obtain a representation of the manifold, and we project the noisy image to the manifold. The projection point is the denoised image. That's the what we call the manifold learning method. And, well, the traditional method is great. It's independent of the content of the image, but on the other hand, it suffers to get less information that you know. So it heavily depends on the content of the image. The existing knowledge that you know already is encoded by the manifold, and that helps you to learn more. For example, if you use a wrong manifold, for example, you use cat instead of cat face instead of human face, you will get something similar to a cat, and not quite the human face. So the fact that you know you are dealing with human face helps you to get something interesting, closer to reality. Otherwise, you use a cat face, you get something somewhat nonsense. So the cat images here, okay? So now, in this way, the central tasks for deep learning are learn the manifold structure from the data and represent the manifold implicitly or explicitly. So, so this is a standard autoencoder. So we have an encoding map from here. We create the input there, and we try to learn how to do things here. And then there are two neurons here, and coming out back to here, decoding map. So that's the architecture, autoencoding architecture. And the encoder takes a sample and maps it to the image here. And the decoder maps C back, just the picture we just drew. The one is on the left, and this part is on the right in that picture. So the autoencoder is trained to minimizing the reconstruction error from the input to the output. We want to minimizing by minimizing among all the possible phi and psi. And L can be looked at the loss function, such as square errors. The reconstruct manifold is used as an approximation of M. So M is a manifold of all the things that we like to see inside there. So for any number of hidden layers K, so then how many layers you want to put in, input and output dimension are several numbers, integers, W naught to WK plus 1. And RW naught to RWK plus 1 is given by specifying a sequence of K natural numbers, W1, W2 to WK, which is mapping sequentially a set of K affine transformations, affine transformation mapping here to here, and a linear transformation from TWK, RWK to RWK plus 1, correspond to the wigs of hidden layers. So each layer has some wigs for us to play with. And then this is from the beginning to the end is represented by this map. So TK plus 1 are each of these matrix that we are dealing with. Each of them is a matrix, a linear map, and sigma is the standard cutting off function. And this gives rise to a mapping composition, and theta represents all the wigs and bias parameters. So that's the way that we represent this definition, DNN. And so this is an encoding map, and let the set of all neurons in the network to be denoted as L. All the subsets is therefore denoted as 2 to the power L. Okay. So now, activate path is defined the following way. The activate path of X consists of all the activate neurons when phi phi theta X is evaluated, and denote as low X is a path going through the sequence of neurons, and this defines a set value functions. Okay, so given a point in X, and we associate a path. Okay, so this is what we call a activate path, and given two points, we call it equivalent. You know, in Euclidean space, if the paths are equivalent to each other, the same activated path, low x1 equal to low x2. So two points in Euclidean space are considered as equivalent if the path that we go through is the same. And this decomposes the ambient space into many cells. Okay? And these cells corresponding to equivalent classes that we just set, low x1 equal to low x2 defined as same cell, in the same cell. So x1 and x2 belongs to there even only if x1 equivalent to x2. And this defines the cell decomposition induced by the encoding map, the encoding map phi that we just defined earlier, phi theta. And so phi theta maps the cell decomposition in the ambient space to a cell decomposition in the latent space. So phi theta, first of all, defines a decomposition, a cell decomposition, and also decomposition in the latent space. So the input manifold here is a Buddha, as mentioned earlier. But then we have a latent decomposition, a representation, and then there's a output here, reconstruct manifold, in the autoencoder pipeline that we mentioned earlier. And then it defines a different decomposition. This one was the one that we just discussed, the cell decomposition given by many piecewise linear space. And then the map that we mentioned gives rise to cell decomposition on the latent space here, and then given a new cell decomposition here. So these are piecewise linear encoding decoding maps induced cell decomposition of the ambient space and the latent spaces. So that's how we see the complexity. So the rectifier linear complexity can be defined in the following way. is the upper bound of the number of pieces of all PL functions represented by n, okay, given by n, and we maximize it, okay. So this defines a complexity. It's number, so n is the number of pieces of the PL function that you see, okay. So rectified piece linear complexity give a measurement of the representation capability of a neural network. So the neural network, we just gone through, the theta is changing given different neurons and all that. Then we get a maximum complexity depending on the cell decomposition. Well, a trivial lemma is actually just the maximum number of paths one can get when cutting a d-dimensional space with n hyperplanes. And let's denote it by that, by this number. So this d dimension and n hyperplanes. And of course, that's the maximum you can get. and this is just proof by induction, and not much more than that. So there's a proof here. And this comes out because of this induction procedure. Okay. So given such a weight W naught up to WK plus 1, it represents PL mappings from RW naught to RWK plus 1, several of them. And naturally, they are just simplest way to give the complexity is just that you take a sequence of products, and each product is given by, each piece of the product are given by this number that we mentioned earlier, and we take product of them. So the complexity, the linear rectified complexity of n is simply given by the upper bound of this. So there's upper bound, universal upper bound, depending only on the weight. And so that's easy to see. So linear rectifiable manifolds, the embed in Rn, and we say that it's linear rectifiable if there exists an affine map, mapping Rn to Rm such that the restriction of phi on m is homeomorphism. So this is a map, a homeomorphism, R2 map to R. In this case, m equal to 1, n equal to 2. And phi is called a corresponding rectified linear map of m. It's a nice projection here, but this one you cannot. So in general, so M is n-dimensional manifold, m-dimensional manifold, embed into Rn, Euclidean n-space. You take endless coordinate charts on M, and each chart is linear rectifiable, supposedly, and you have a rectified linear map there. Then we call this endless to be linear rectifiable, endless of M. So manifold itself cannot be linear rectified, but on the other hand, each piece can be, and you put them together. And you define complexity of such a thing. And namely, if M is M-dimensional manifold embedded in Rn, the linear rectifiable map is, complexity of them is defined to be this number, and is defined to a minimum of all possible rectifiable atlas there. So smallest possible way to decompose manifold into chunks so that you can linear rectify it. Yeah. So that's natural definition. Well, and this, you get the, for the encoding map, suppose M is M-dimensional manifold embedded in Rn. A continuous map is called encoding map. If restrict to M, it's homeomorphism there. And so, now we have a condition given this weight, represent a PL mapping, Rn to Rm. If M is an m-dimensional manifold embedded in here, and phi theta, as we discussed before, is an encoding mapping of this, then the rectified linear complexity of n is no less than the rectified linear complexity of this. So that's easy to see. So this is the minimum, so it's less than this guy, and it's less than this other guy because you're taking supremum of this. One supremum, one infimum. So this complexity is therefore constrained by the left-hand side and the right-hand side. And this gives you a way to measure things. For example, if you, this is only this is an example, if n dimensional manifold embed into Rn plus 1, you can map the Gauss map, it's mapping the normal of the manifold hypersurface into the sphere, and then you can map into the real projective space, which is just antipodal Sn quotient by the antipodal map. And this is a M, there's a composite, it defines a map from M to RPM. And if it covers the whole of RPM, then M is not linear rectifiable because you get both the point and the antipodal point together, so you cannot project clearly. So, well, as a result, you can use this to prove that if you get a piano curve, it's a curve, you just keep on duplicating yourself. And you can prove that if Cn is a piano curve, then the complexity is bigger than 4 to the power n plus 1, making use of that previous argument. So, in this way, you can prove that given any neural network, W0 up to Wk plus 1, there's always a manifold embedded into the RW0 such M cannot be encoded by the neural network in that way that we see because of this inequality. Okay, so let's see how the deep learning controls the probability measure. So we have a white noise in the left-hand side, a generative model converts a white noise into a phasal image. And we have this gang overview. Is that a generator? It's like a forger trying to produce some counterfeit material, and the discriminator is like the police trying to detect the forged items. So there's a discriminator here, and there's a generator here, and there's noise here. The generator generates samples and data sample put in here. And then we compete to get the answers. And this automatically generates samples. The requirement for the data sample is reduced. Data sample distribution can be arbitrary without closed form expression. So there's a lot of merits to it. So putting in this more schematic way is generator is on the left-hand side, the noise source come in, and you generate examples, and there are real examples to compare. There's discriminators, there's real fake. And so this gives you a model, a good model. So here is similar, the distribution, discriminator, real distribution, and generated distribution, and this is generator, the white noise coming here. So they try to iterate several times and finally get the answer to be correct. So this is a learning process. So we want to explain in the way that we like to see in terms of geometry or the optimal transportation later. So now we have an image space X, and we have a supporting manifold sigma, and we have a latent space, and W would be the Wasserstein distance. The distance, this is a distribution we calculate, this real distribution. We want to compare these two distributions, and this gives you the distance, Wasserstein distance. And we will discuss about it in the later slides. So new training data distribution, and theta is a uniform distribution in here, and push forward. And so G theta is the encoding map, give you the distribution in here. And G is a generator, compute G theta. And D is a discriminator, measures the Wasserstein distance between these two measures. nu here and this mu. And so we can compute the distance between two distributions. So it maps a fixed probability distribution theta to the training data probability distribution nu. And that's in this picture, which reproduces what we just said in a figure, in a previous figure. So what is Rosenstein's, this phase that we just discussed? So given a manifold, all the probability distribution on M from an infinite dimensional manifold, which we call the Rosenstein space, space of all probability distribution. The distance between them is given by the so-called Rosenstein distance. And how do we define Rosenstein distance? It's defined in the following way. Given two measures, mu and nu, appear on the manifold, there's a unique optimal mass transportation map, mapping M to M, which maps mu to nu, they are probability measure, with the minimum transportation cost. This transportation cost of this map is called the Rosenstein distance between mu and nu. So you want to compare two probability distribution using a map which is called optimal mass transportation, and the cost will be the distance between them naturally defined, comparing two distributions. Okay. So now the question is to figure out what the optimal mass distribution transportation map. So how does it work? Well, given two bounded domain in Euclidean space with probability measure mu and nu with equal total measure, then we define map from x to y which preserve measure. Preserve measure means that whenever you see a measurable set, the measure in the left is the same as measure on the right. When you do the transportation, compare them, okay? You get two measure exactly the same whenever you have a measurable set in Y. So this is called measure preserving map. If T is a smooth map, then the measure preserving map has a equation, because mu x dx is equal to nu y dy, because two measures are the same. This is the definition of equal, write it in infinitesimal form. You write d mu s in terms of Radon-Nicodian derivative, you get these two equality. Now there's a Jacobian between x and y, and that Jacobian, this equation can be formulated in terms of this, okay? Determinant of the Jacobian give rise to mu divided by nu, composite Tx. It's just calculus telling you how to transform the map. So dt is the Jacobian, and the question is how do you create t? And in many cases, you can create t in a nice manner. But in any case, the cost of moving unit mass from a point X to a point Y, sometimes we call it CXY, to move one point to another point. So you need some cost. For example, you drive it by bus or by a rocket, whatever it is, a given cost. The total transportation cost is integrate of all of them together. Okay, the total cost of moving all the goods in one place to another place is defined by this way. Okay, so we want to find optimal cost, and that depends on how you define the cost function. The cost function, there are many ways to define it. The most more than 200 years ago. He's a Greek geometer. And he used the cost function to be just simple x minus y in absolute value. But you can use different functions, okay? Many different functions. And once you use different functions, you get different answers, naturally, because you're minimizing according to this cost function. And if C you use different form, you will get different answer. But the minimum cost is called is optimal mass transportation map. You find a T that makes sure that you minimize the whole thing. And the Wasserstein distance that I explained before is just the minimum among all these things. But then you have to fix the cost function. So such a distance depends on how you choose the cost function. You choose C, then you define the distance between two probability density by minimizing such a thing with T, using this C to be the cost function. So WC will be different depending on different cost function. And this there's a famous work, probably 60 years ago, maybe older. He relaxed transportation maps to transportation schemes. So find an optimal transportation scheme, namely a joint probability density on a product space. You're trying to make X to Y. Instead, he look at the probability measure in the product space. And he want to satisfy the two conditions. The measure project to X will be mu, and the measure project to Y will be nu. So the probability density on X and probability density on Y. You want to find a joint probability density on a product space so that when you induce it, project it onto the first vector, it's mu, and project into second space, it will be y. And you want to minimize the cost, which he defines to be this number. So here you don't need to use a map. So you take cxy, which is the cost function between x and y, and d low xy is a measure on here, on a joint space, product space. And you satisfy this condition, and you minimize it among all low. So this defines the distance between mu and nu. So, he got the Nobel Prize in economics in 1975 based on this work. And then this problem that he proposed has a dual form. So he said, find the function phi is defined in the first space, x, and psi on the second space. Instead of looking at low, you look at integral phi on the first space and psi in the second space with the condition that sum up less than cxy. The cost function has to be dominating phi and psi, and you look at the measure in both sides. And he maximizes it instead of minimizing. So many optimal, minimization problem has a dual problem. Instead of minimizing, you maximize. This happens in many subjects. And so this is a good thing to use. And under this theory of duality, and this defines is something called C transform. Phi Cy is equal to infimum Cxy minus phi x. And the duality contour of which dual problem can be transformed as this one. So instead of doing minimizing procedure, you do a maximize procedure, except phi c is defined by this. So there are equivalent problem. And now, a very important work was due to Brenier, I think in the 1970s, maybe 1980s, I forgot. If the cost function is quadratic, and quadratic function is a really nice function, make things smooth. And there exists a convex function U, unit up to a constant, so that the unit optimal transportation map found by contourage can be defined to be the gradient map. So the map T that contourage found can be written as gradient of some function, this convex function. And this convex function is sometimes called the potential. It's called Brenier potential. And this is actually tremendous improvement in many ways, because finding a T is difficult to do because it's a vector value function, multi-variable. U is only a scalar function. A scalar function is always much easier to handle compared with a vector value function. And the regularity and many other things are much easier to be controlled. So therefore, Bernier in this case, in this special case of cost function, reduce the problem to this. You just write t to a gradient of u. And this is a potential. Once you have a potential, it becomes a scalar function, and things are much easier. But of course, it is defined up to a constant. This is similar to Maxwell's equation.
So yeah. Is this true for every convex function?
No.
This is the unique. So there can be many convex functions and
CXY is quadratic.
Yeah, so suppose you fix C equal to this.
Then you get the T, it can be written as this.
Okay, so then is it always true that given a U satisfying this Bernier condition is optimal?
No, you have to set your equation.
Right, so you still have to minimize amount of U, right? Or like optimal.
No, you have to set your equation, which is called Mong-Champion equation. That's what I'm going to describe now.
Okay.
So we know T can be written as gradient of U, but U has a satisfied equation to be the unit optimal equation. That's a beautiful part of it. We can calculate it. Otherwise, we don't know how to calculate it. So the equation is this one. Because we have a Jacobi equation, which I just described, you can more or less write down the equation. I mean, once you write down, you write down this definition, and use the previous definition, you see? There's this equation, you see? This one. This is the equation that must be satisfied for all maps which optimize, which measure preserving. The transformation T is now gradient of U. The second differentiation of a potential function is a Jacobian. Okay? So determinant here is a Jacobian. Okay? That's why you get this equation. See, you get this equation. So this is the equation that come up with that give you the optimal condition. So this is called Mong-Champion equation. And in order for this to be reasonable, the Hessian here is positive definite. And this makes equation to be elliptic. And this elliptic equation was studied for a long time, starting by Mong himself. And once you have this equation, there are many things you can do. Now, the distance function, if the distance function, cost function, is this way, where h is a strictly convex function, and then this potential, contrary to potential, gives the optimal mass transportation map directly in this form. And if it is actually quadratic, not just that, it sets around this relation, the U sets around this relation. And U is a generator, and phi is a discriminator in the previous neural network picture. And it defines a generator using U, and phi is a discriminator. It's just transformed accordingly here. In the case when we use CXY to be this. So now let's take a look of this. Now we want to explain to you how U and phi relate, and also how this equation can be solved. So there's a famous problem called Minkowski problem by the beginning of 20th century. Minkowski studied this problem. Actually, end of 19th century, Minkowski studied this problem. So given a polyhedron in general, in R2 is polygon. So you get an edge, and you get its length, AI, and you have a unit normal vector, NI. So we know a polygon is determined by these numbers, AI and NI. And you must satisfy a condition, namely summation AI NI equals 0. This is in order for the polygon to be a closed polygon, and you must satisfy this condition. And this is easy to verify. You can do a simple thing to verify it. Summation AI times NI equals 0. Now, it turns out this is the only condition for AI and NI to be satisfied in order to produce a closed polygon. Okay, so this is called Minkowski problem. Minkowski problem said that given vectors NI and AI, I want to produce a polygon satisfy the condition that the AI is the edge length and NI is the normal. Now this can be generalized to high dimension, and in that case, we are taking the area and the unit normal of the face. AI is the area of the face. And you want to find compact convex polytor with exactly k equal dimension 1 minus 1 faces, so the area is equal to AI and NI is perpendicular to the face. So this is a high dimensional generalization of Minkowski problem. So given these numbers, AI and NI, you want to construct a polyhedron, set like that. And this, of course, is more difficult than the one-dimensional situation. And you can do the same problem for high dimension. And then you get a high-dimensional equation that we will see. Minkowski proved that it always exists, and also is unit up to a translation. So the polytor is actually unit up to translation. And this is a very important cornerstone in geometry. Convex geometry, that this can be solved and is unique. For doing that, Minkowski actually proved several important inequalities. It's called Brun-Minkowski inequality. Given any pair of compact convex set A and B, it must satisfy this inequality. This is a beautiful and important inequality, and it's useful for many purposes, and it's one of the major steps in order to prove the Minkowski problem. So now, Alexandrov studied similar problem. He take a compact convex domain in Rn and distinct points in Rn and some ais going to be the area, the volume element, and the total volume should be summation AI. He wants to prove that there exists a piecewise linear convex function fx defined by this function. This function is just linear function defined by the hyperplane. Well, hi is just a constant. Okay, x dot pi is the linear function defined by the hyperplane. You take the maximum of it, it's defined the supporting function for the polyhedron. So it's a way to look at a constructive way to produce solution. Now, so I studied this problem, Minkowski problem, about 40 years ago. And in order to adapt to the thing that we are talking here, this was done about 6 years ago. So given a compact convex domain in Euclidean space, and yi up to y1 up to yk are distinct points in Euclidean space. And suppose mu is a measure, positive continuous measure on omega. Then suppose we are given you some numbers, some measures, mu1, nu1 up to nu k, so the summation of them is the measure, total measure of omega. Then there exists a vector hi, so that if I define u by this function piecewise, maximum linear function, x dot pi plus hi, you satisfy then that nu I, which is given, equal to the measure defined by wi intersection omega. And wi is defined in this way. And then we can find u, the potential that we are looking at. This would be the potential we are looking for relate to this Minkowski, relate to the optimal transportation. And h is actually can be defined as a maximum point of the convex function of this type. So this is the way to find the potential. Okay. Now, this appears in this paper. If we look at the the geometry of such a plot of the previous picture, you take the omega, which is the domain, I take a cylinder through the boundary. The cylinder is truncated by the convex polyhedron and the xy plane. So this is a polyhedron and the xy plane. And this is the volume. And the energy term that we discussed earlier, that we in the previous slides, is actually simply this cylinder, volume of the cylinder. So therefore, we can understand those functions in terms of geometry. It's just volume of the truncated cylinder. And the concave energy, which we call Alessandro potential, just written in this form. And this guy is the truncated volume, as I mentioned before. And this energy is the volume beneath the parabola. And this is an interesting interpretation. And the gradient of this potential is the difference between the target measure and the current measure of each cell. So that's good. So gradient of the energy that we define is just the difference two measures. And the Hessian energy is the length ratios of edge and the dual edge, defined the following way. At each point, we can talk about its Hessian. Now, so this new training data distribution and the theta uniform distribution, which I mentioned earlier, can be therefore computed by computing this. Yeah.
Is the way you're defining edge and dual edge, is it specific to this two-dimension case? Like in higher dimensions, like the cells, like for every edge, it corresponds to like a hyper sort of hyper plane.
Right. This is more complicated.
Okay.
Okay. So we compute the Wolfenstein distance using this dual formula. And we compute the contour-rich potential. The generator computes a measure preserving transportation map so that G theta star theta, the uniform distribution equal mu theta equals nu. And for the Gang model, we do the minimax optimization. And in the L1 case, then we have this minimization procedure where everything is one ellipsis. But it's better to use the L2 case. The Brainier potential, as I mentioned, is equal to this. And this discriminator computes phi. Hence, in theory, it can be obtained from the optimal D without training. And D can be obtained from the optimal G without training. We need to compute the Mohn-Chern pair equation. So therefore, the neural network, in a way, is redundant. And there's no need to compete between D and G. If we can compute the optimal transportation directly. But the optimal transportation is not trivial to compute, but it can be done as we outlined the Alessandro Minkowski problem. And the theory went back, as I said, to almost 100 years. The computations actually were studied in the last 40 or 50 years. So let's say the target probability measure is approximate, let's say, by this measure. So delta function yi with some weight and nu I. And this is look at the optimal, discrete optimal transportation given a compact convex domain omega in Rn and points in Rn and ais and the weights. And we want to find transportation map T from the left-hand side into the right-hand side. So the volume of the inverse image of ai is the given one, ai. And we want to minimizing the transportation cost, which is given by this formula. So that's the transportation map we are looking at. And so in order to do it, What we do is constructive. Given yi in y, we construct a hyperplane by doing this, and then compute the upper envelope of the planes, and then define uh in this way. We produce a power diagram of omega, so that the h, you see that the whole thing is equal to union wih, like this. This is a polyhedron decomposition. Adjust the height, h. The height is input, but then we adjust it so that at last you get the right number. So we are doing variation principle on h, moving h I juggling around to reach the construction of the optimal transportation, the procedure. The procedure is effective, and you can do it. And so adjust the height of each hyperplane, we get this measure that we want, and this is an effective computation, as I said. So this gives you a way to compute these things without doing iterations. Now, let's, at the end of the talk, we want to explain a little bit about this Mach collapse that we observe. The gangs suffer from Mach collapsing. The generating distribution miss some Machs. And so it may also generate unrealistic samples. And we want to show how it comes out in here. So suppose we have two domains, bound domains, omega and omega star. And we have two measures, F and G are L1. And it's satisfied the total measure is the same. And we assume F and G are bound between two positive constants. So it cannot be close to zero or go to infinity, both of them, both measure. And then, so in each of them, we have a potential functions. An optimal map, Tu, is given by this formula. And we differentiate the formula. This definition of U is this, getting this formula. And then we obtain this equation, and with the boundary condition. So this is more general than previous case. And for this formula, it depends on the cost function as before. If C is the square quadratic, then we solve this equation. With the boundary condition, we want to map omega to omega star. This is a non-trivial boundary condition. And now this can be solved, turns out, given F and G, satisfy those conditions that I mentioned. But it depends on the regularity of F and G. Here is Hölder continuous, and this is convex, then U would be C2 alpha. And if it's C0 and only, then U is W2p. So in the integral sense, like C2 alpha. And when p is large, then it's good for continuous. Otherwise, it's not necessarily continuous. And if omega and omega star are uniformly convex and C2 alpha, then U is C2 alpha. So all these are reasonable standard by now in the development of Mohn-Sempere equation in the last 40 years. But we need to know more. But this is already pretty good. And there's a result by these three gentlemen in Australia. And this is about 10 years ago, I think, this paper. He said the function is C free smooth, if the cost function is smooth, Fg and positive, and satisfy some inequalities. These are constraints on C. Constraint on C. And this is interesting constraint and like curvature function of the cost function C. So these are, of course, more general than the square. X minus y square, and these are the conditions they put down in order to prove regularity. Now, of course, you may say that this is kind of ridiculous, but turns out this condition is sharp in some ways. That means if this condition is violated, the function is no more smooth, and this causes trouble when it's not smooth. So. Well, let's take a look. Given a convex function, we define subgradient, as you can see. It's just that the supporting function at that point. So all these the hyperplanes, P is a vector, a vector corresponds to a hyperplane, and the hyperplane are supporting hyperplanes. And there's and the potential U is defensible X if its gradient is singleton. At one point of a convex hypersurface, if there's only one supporting plane, then it's C1 there, otherwise it's not. Okay? Otherwise it's look like a cone or a wedge. So we can classify the points according to the dimension of the supporting planes, how big it is. This could be more than one dimension, so K equals CO1, 2, etc. And, well, there's a theorem due to Figari in two dimensions. So two compact, two bound open set, if F and G are probability density, they are CO outside omega, lambda, and are bound away from CO infinity on omega, lambda, respectively. Then you look at the optimal transport map provided by the Bernier theorem. Then there's two relative closed sets sitting there with measure zero, such that outside them is homomorphism, which is Hölder continuous. So there's a statement, but there's something goes wrong at those points. Outside those points, they are good, but at those points, they are not good. And these are the pictures which are interesting, which are related to the collapsing MOOCs. So the maps, these points, these are the funny points, measure zero. And the map is good outside the outside those points. And this point is blow up to a circle. And this figure, this graph, is blow up to these three points. Okay, so this point and here, and so is here, going to here. So so this is interesting. The Bernier map is trying to match things, and it does its best, but the image is not convex. If image is convex, they are good, but image is not convex, they provide some strange behavior. But this strange behavior captures some interesting thing for you. Singular set is always interesting, despite it sounds bizarre, but that's always give you something interesting. So this continuous optimal transportation map produced by such an implementation that we see here, so you see the map produced here, and then there's discontinuity here. And based on regularity theorem, these are examples of singular sets. And so maybe look at it here is easier. So the optimal transportation between a solid ball, so the whole bunny in the interior is a ball, and we map the ball into this bunny. They are singular sets. And the singular sets appear on the foldings on the boundary surface. The boundary surface is the bunny itself, and you see some singular sets at the folding points there. And this you see better in this way. Singular set are the foldings on the boundary surface. And this has interesting phenomena. They are discontinuous, but the potential itself is continuous. You see, the transportation map is a gradient of the potential. The potential is continuous, but the gradient is not. So the projection of ridges are the discontinuity singular sets. So you see the singular sets here. And this gives rise to interesting phenomena. So these are the points project. And so the deep neural network can only represent continuous mappings, but the transportation maps are discontinuous on singular sets. The target mappings are outside the function space of DNNS. This conflict induces smoke collapsing. So that is the proposal. In order to avoid smoke collapsing, the optimal transportation map is discontinuous, but the potential itself is continuous. So we should keep the nice potential. So the neural network should keep the Bernier potential instead of its gradient, namely its transport transition map. Because the transportation map is discontinuous, it may break apart in several ways. But the way that it appears is actually interesting because it tells you a great deal about the information about the situation. And when the mode collapses, the training process is unstable and does not converge. The searching converges to one of the multiple connect components of lambda. The mapping converges to one continuous branch of the desired transformation map. This means we encounter a mode collapsing. The training process leads to a transportation map, which covers all the MOOCs successfully, but also covers some region outside lambda. This will induce the phenomena generating unrealistic samples. So this example that appears when you take the path and you bypass going up and down, you will see some place where the two eyes are different color, which is unrealistic. So a path through the singularity, passing through some of this singularity that we mentioned. So it shows the transportation map is discontinuous. So I think, I don't know where the publication go. So anyway, conclusion more or less. So we solve the Mong-Shan-Pair equation and reduce to a convex optimization, which has unique solution, and the optimization won't be trapped in a local optimal. The Hessian matrix of the energy has explicit formulation. Newton's method can be applied with second order convergency or quasi-Newton method. So these are good. The approximation accuracy can be fully controlled by the density of the sampling density by using Monte Carlo method. The algorithm can be refined to a hierarchy or self-adaptive to further improvement. And so we compare this with several other methods by experiment, and our method is on the bottom, and the other method was on the top. And these are the examples. This is a failure case where many faces come out to be strange. Well, you can see some of the figures are strange. And here is our model on the right and different in the left. So you single out some of the faces, you can see. So you can see how it looks. The faces are reasonably good in this model. So we see the experiment that come out from this method, which shows the one that we have is pretty good. So the conclusion is that the intrinsic pattern natural data can be represented by manifold distribution hypothesis. The deep learning system has two major tasks, manifold learning and probability distribution transformation. And the optimal transportation method can be used to accomplish the second task. But the theory, the generator, and discriminator should collaborate instead of compete with each other. And the regularity theory of the Mong-Shan-Pair equation explains the MOOC collapsing. So that's what we saw, hopefully. Anyway, we stop here. Thank you.
Any questions for Professor Yao? So there's probably something that I misunderstood. So in high dimension, solving the Mong-Shan-Pair equation is not a convex problem.
It's still a convex problem.
It's a convex problem. But when you add this formulation in terms of the height for the Minkowski problem.
Yeah. It's also convex.
Or the energy functional that you wrote.
All this are good when it's convex. When it's not convex, encounter regularity problems, singularities. And how the singularity behaves are very interesting. In the image, manifold is not convex. We encounter regularity problem.
Okay.
What it means is that if everything is convex, we see very nice regularity. When it's not, then we encounter interesting singularity behavior, which actually gives rise to a lot of interesting qualitative questions that you can ask. Okay? Like the bunny. The bunny, you map a solid spore into the bunny by brute force when the bunny is not convex.
You described a different mathematical viewpoint on the problem of generating adversarial, generating examples.
Yeah.
Is it also faster numerically when you try to generate new examples compared to classical techniques?
Yeah, we did quite well with this.
Quite well means faster,
faster,
about the same?
Faster.
Like how much?
I know, you know probably better.
10 times?
Yeah.
So practically, how do you enforce, so you represent the mapping as a neural net, how do you enforce convexity? Like what constraints?
Well, the convexity depends on the problem you're dealing with.
But you would represent the map?
The map is produced by computation, by solving differential equation. But the manifold itself depends on the problem you are dealing with.
So you wouldn't encode the potential as a
potential. You compute the potential. Depends.
No, but the convex part, if I understand, is in computing the Wasserstein distance. It's not in computing the generating map. This is still a neural network, right? So that is
the encoding map still provisional.
So the convex part is computing the Wasserstein distance.
The Wasserstein distance part is optimal transportation.
You need to compute a cost function that we use optimal transportation to compute.
But
is the image manifold convex? Image manifold need not be convex, but then you get singularities.
Because we know that images typically can have transforms like translations.
Yeah.
Like all the Leo Givas kind of things where it represents image themselves with transportation, I call them ink mover distances.
Yeah.
So if the image themselves are defined by transportations, they're probably not going to be convex in the normal sense. Mixture of image, a mixture of two faces, rarely a face.
Well, if it's not convex, then you probably take a convex half to a computation and see how it comes out. Yeah.
Another question. In standard GANs, you're using a particular architecture of the neural network.
Yeah.
Elements in each layer. Where does it enter in your formulation, the architecture of the network? Is it only in upper bounding the number of linear cells, or is there a particular way in which different architectures are going to be represented differently in your formulation?
I think it's all represented by this number of cells that we are using. Because when we solve the Minkowski problem,
only the number of cells for which you had very rough estimate.
Yeah.
You multiply the number of linear partitions in each layer.
Yeah, it's still a huge dimension. We triangulate and do the number of cells. When we compute the Minkowski problem, you use polyhedrons. The number of polyhedrons could be very large.
Then I'm afraid that you are going to lose efficiency. Because you have such a loose upper bound on the number of cells.
That's a very rough estimate we have.
Right.
The more precise estimate probably can be improved by studying it more carefully.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if the Hessian of the Brenier potential at a point
is
very non-isotropic,
This
is kind of an indication for the generative network that this is a bad point because you're close to a discontinuity, I guess.
Yeah.
Are you actually using some kind of score like that to indicate back to the GAN that
what it's currently generating is not so good, so that it avoids those points, or is
yeah, I think that should be used. I don't know whether we use that. Yeah,
yeah, you do.
Yeah. What's the actual score function? Like, how do
you can kind of really find that? Basically, you can find the singularity set. When you find that, you should cross the singularity set. Within the singularity set, you're generating a lot of unrealistic examples, like bottleneck examples. Yeah, so that's giving you a very good understanding for that.
Actually, singular set sometimes is a blessing, it's not necessarily a bad thing. We understand smooth manifold by forcing it to be singular in geometry. So sometimes you may not need to make changes, you just study the singularity carefully, how the tangent lines and how the moves changes. So in algebraic geometry, we what we call blowing up. We blow up those points, study how the structure of the map look like. So singularity need not be a bad thing if we can control it. Okay. So strings of both.
You mean it's not necessarily an indication that you're not at a good point? Or
right. Sometimes singularity reveal the global structure in a more precise manner than what you think. So in algebraic geometry, we study smooth manifold, but degenerate it to singular manifold, and the singular manifold actually simpler everywhere except with the singularity. And we get information from that singularity. That's how algebraic geometry using singularity. Okay. Now we know there's this theorem due to Hironaka that every singularity can be resolved by blowing up. And so this blowing up stratum and all that are useful to understand the manifold. Okay. Yeah.
Can you speculate on the distribution hypothesis plus the manifold hypothesis, whether this is also enough to explain the transfer learning kind of advances that we are seeing, that where we are just using these representations coming from these images and using them for some downstream tasks? Or do you think that we need to understand the geometry of like transfer data sets more than just a single data set?
I don't know. I think the transportation is trying to is based on this manifold assumption, but manifold embeddable into Euclidean space is actually a very very general assumption. That I think virtually everything can be embedded into big Euclidean space as far as the dimension is large. So I don't think one should worry too much about this assumption. Yeah.
So I think I must miss something because I'm wondering whether in your generator it's really kind of just those piecewise linear functions, the unbindable piecewise linear function, and when you optimize the generator, you just adjust the height that hi to kind of to get the generator. If that's the case, then it's very strange to me because then you can only generate the data in the training data, you cannot really generate a novel image at all. But in the end, we indeed see some novel kind of new images. So I think what's the generator you are really using?
I think you must have read our articles before. So basically, after you're calculating this discrete optimal transportation map, you do linear interpolation. So there's another step of linear interpolation. So therefore, you cover the whole manifold.
Instead of discrete examples.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so let's thank Yao again.